Father, we bless your holy name. We give you all the glory. We give you all the adoration tonight. We lift up high your name, O God, and say that, Father, you are worthy, your mighty Lord Jesus, to be praised. I give you all the glory. I give you all the adoration. I say thank you, Lord Jesus, for watching over us, O God, and making us, taking us through another week, O God. We bless your holy name, and we glorify you in the mighty name of Jesus. Have your way tonight, O God, and let your will be done, O Lord and my Savior, tonight. Let us hear your voice and your voice alone. I submit myself unto you, Lord, as an empty vessel. I pray that, Lord, you will let your word flow through me, O God. Thine ear and all glory and adoration shall be unto you. I commit all listeners into your hands, O God, Jesus, that, Lord, Jesus, you will protect and keep them, that the enemy would never be able to steal your word from them. That, Lord, tonight will be a blessing unto them. That all glory and adoration, Lord, shall be unto you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, and we bless your holy name, even for an answered prayer. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Yes, as I said earlier on tonight, I would like to share something with you which I have entitled, My Power is Perfected in Your Weakness. My power is perfected in your weakness. God's power is what is perfected in our weakness. God's power is perfected in our weakness. As children of God, we do ask a lot of questions when we are going through situations, when we are going through hard times, when things are not going the way we want it to be, when things are not working out the way we think it should be. As children of God, we begin to ask certain questions. Is God really there? Is God really with me? Am I really in the right books of God? What is going on between myself and God? What is happening to me? Am I not as a Christian as my other brothers and sisters are? Why are things going on right with them and things are not working out for me? We begin to ask a lot of questions when things begin to go wrong in our lives. But I believe that by the grace of God, after tonight, we will know that the power of God can only be seen in our lives. The hand of God can only be seen lifted up in our lives. When we experience some kind of weaknesses, in our weakness, that is where the power of God is seen. And where we feel we can do nothing, where we feel we are at our end, that is when God can glorify himself in our lives. God doesn't want to share his glory with you, as I always say. Neither does he want to share his glory with any other person. He wants his glory for himself. That is why he doesn't want your effort in whatever he wants to do in your life. That is why you are experiencing that weakness. That is why you think you have come to an end. That is why you think you can do nothing. At a point where you can do nothing, that is when God comes in and glorifies himself. So when you are being pushed by the enemy to a point where you think, no, at this point I can do nothing, when you are being beaten by the enemy to cause some weaknesses in your life, that is when you should know that God is up to something in your life. God is up to something in your life. God only uses the enemy as an instrument so he can bless you. God uses the enemy as an instrument that he can bless you. God is not wicked. God is not, that does not turn his eyes on you. He only allows the enemy into your life so that he can glorify himself. He allows the enemy into your life so he can magnify himself. That is why David said, he prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. How will he prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies? The enemies must be allowed to come into your life so that God will surface and glorify himself. That your enemies may bow before you. That your enemies may bow before you. That his glory will be seen. His glory will be seen. I want us to see something from the book of 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, the verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. It says, this is something that happened in the life of our father Paul. He said, at least I should be exalted above measure, And lest I should be exalted above measure by the word abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given me, a message of a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. Concerning these things, I pleaded with the Lord three times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. He said, the Lord allowed the enemy, he allowed a thorn in my flesh. He allowed the enemy to come into my life and torment my flesh. Lest I exalt myself. The great and mighty things that I do, the great miracles that I do, people receiving their healing, raising the dead, and doing all these things, to prevent me from exalting myself, to prevent me from lifting up myself, the Lord allowed the enemy into my life to torment my flesh. Paul was doing miracles, Paul was doing raising the dead and was doing great and mighty things, but yet he had a problem himself. But Paul, he understood that problem was within to cause him to be able to be submissive to the Lord. And he said, when he prayed to God, when he asked God for what? To touch him, to heal him. This is the response that God gave him. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness. My grace is sufficient for you. For my strength is made perfect in your weakness. For my strength, what? Is made perfect in your weakness. In your weakness is my strength made perfect. In your weakness, what? Is my strength made perfect. My grace is sufficient for you. You are alive just because of my grace. The enemy had wanted to destroy you. He is in your life. All he wanted to do was to destroy you. But my grace has been sufficient. Therefore, this is the only thing that you have on you. The only way for me was to cause you to be humble before me. If I should take this thing away, I might lose you. You might raise yourself, yes, as you said from the beginning. Therefore, my grace is what? Is sufficient for you. I want healing, Father. I want you to heal me. But the Lord is telling him, my grace is what is sufficient, because in your weakness, is my strength. In your weakness is my strength. For the world to know that I am God. For you to know that I am God. For you to know that I am your Father. That need to be in your life so that you could be able to submit yourself unto me. I don't know what is going on in your life. I don't know the kind of prayers that you have prayed to God. I don't know what your heart desires has been to the Lord. But the Lord is telling you that his grace is sufficient. In your weakness is his strength. In your weakness is where he can glorify himself. I don't know the extent to which Paul was suffering from this thorn in his flesh. I don't know the extent to which it is. But probably, if it were to be me, or it were to be you, or it were to be any other person, maybe that would have led to his death. But even in that, Paul was still alive. Paul was still able to go around. Paul was still able to do the things of God. Therefore, I believe that when Paul goes and can say, thank you, Jesus, for taking me and bringing me back. Even though I have this stone, even though I have this pain in me, you always watch over me. I always have my life. He glorifies God. He magnifies God for providing what? Strength. For granting him the grace to be alive, even though he had that thorn in his flesh. In your weakness is my strength. In that weakness, I am able to glorify myself. In that weakness, I am able to magnify myself. In that weakness, I am able to show that I am God. People may see you and wonder, that, oh, but with this thing on you, with this kind of pain, you are always able to go and come. It is the glory of God. It is to the glory of God. In your weakness is God's strength. In your weakness is God magnified. People see what you are going through, but yet you live. People see what you are going through, but you are able to survive. That is the glory of God. Had it not been God in the life of this brother, had it not been God in the life of this sister, where would he have been? Look at the situation in which he is in. Many people have been in that situation and had not survived. But he is in that situation and he is still alive. It glorifies the God that you serve. It magnifies the God that you serve. In your weakness is my strength. Where you think you have finished, where you think there is nothing more you can do, where you think there is no hope, there is nothing to believe for, or there is nothing to live for, that is when God glorifies himself. Today, at this point in life, where I have gotten to in life, there is nothing I can do anymore. I cannot achieve my aims in life. This prophecy that has been laid upon my life can never come to pass. Look at the age. Look at my age. Look at my age. Look at the situation in which I am in. Look at the conditions in which I am. I cannot walk into that destiny. I cannot see that dream fulfilling in my life. I cannot see the glory of God in my life. I don't think I can even experience that blessings of God. But one thing I want you to know tonight, that at that point where you have given up, at that point where you think that nothing can be good, nothing good can come in your life, that is when God glorifies himself. In your weakness, that is where God shows his strength. In your weakness, that is where God shows his strength. Now, if we should read something from the book of Romans, the chapter 4, the verse 16 to 21. Romans chapter 4, the verse 16 to 21. Romans 4, 16, 21. It said, therefore, it is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of faith of Abraham, who is the father of all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations. In the presence of him who he believed, God, in the presence of him whom he believed, God who gives life to the dead, and cause those things which do not exist as though they did. Who contrary to hope, in hope believed, so that he became the father of many nations, according to what was spoken, so shall your descendants be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead. What? So shall your descendant be. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old. And the deadness of Sarah's womb. Abraham was promised to be the father of many nations. Abraham was what? Was promised to be the father of many nations. A promise was pronounced upon his life. A promise was pronounced upon his life. The reason why Abraham left his father's house was because of what? God's promise given to him. God pressed him to leave and go to an unknown land so that he will bless him and make him a father of many nations. Abraham was young when he left his father's house. Abraham had lived out of his father's land for so many years, believing God that whatever promises that has been made to him, whatever promises that has been made to him will surely come to pass. Moses, David has aged. He has aged. He was now 100 years. He has aged 100 years. At a point in time, the wife said, look, this promise that God said this promise that God gave you can never materialize because now we are growing old. And we need to work. The promise of God needs to be fulfilled. Therefore, let us do things according to our own power and according to our own mind. So what? Moses, Abraham went in with a maidservant and had a child. Now, at the age 100 years, the reason why I made us read this Romans chapter 4, verse 16 to 21, for us to know the state in which Abraham was in before the blessings of God was manifested in his life. The Bible says, what? Abraham was dead. That means he was weak. He had nothing. There was nothing active within him. He said the womb of his wife, Sarah, was dead. So there was no way Sarah could give birth because the womb was dead. The womb was dead. That is when they were weak, when they had no power, when they had no ability to fulfill the promises of God. That was when the strength of God was fulfilled. That was when the hand of God was lifted. Abraham was weak. Abraham had lost all hope. The Bible says, when the man of God, when God appeared unto Abraham and Sarah and promised them reminded them of his promise, Sarah laughed because she knew that she was dead. Her womb was dead. She had no ability to give birth to a child. She had no ability to give birth to a child. She knew her husband. She knew that her husband had no power to make her pregnant. So what are you talking about? That promise that you gave can never be fulfilled through me, Sarah. It can never be fulfilled through me. It can never be fulfilled at this time because my wife, my husband is dead, my womb is dead, and there is no way we can give birth to a child. They thought, they looked at their own strength. They looked at the state in which they were in. But the Lord God that we serve, what the Bible says, in our weakness, that is when his strength is fulfilled. Or that is when his strength is portrayed. He is a God of impossibility. Therefore, you must be at a point of what? Things being impossible. You must be at a point of impossibility that God would appear and begin to glorify himself. The Bible says Abraham and Sarah were weak. But that was the time that the Lord decided what? To cause his word to come to pass in your lives. It doesn't matter the state in which you are in. It doesn't matter the circumstances that surround you. It doesn't matter the state in which you are in. Whatever the Lord has said concerning your life will surely come to pass. It does not take your strength. It does not take your ability. It does not take your wisdom. It does not take anything of yours for God to fulfill his word concerning his life, your life. God, as I said, does not want to share his glory with you. That is why you have got to a point where you think nothing can happen. But I am telling you, brother, my sister, God is about to glorify himself in your life. In your weakness, that is when God's strength is revealed. In your weakness, that is when God's strength is revealed. When we read something from the book of Kings, Read something for the book of 1 Kings chapter 17. 1 Kings chapter 17. 1 Kings chapter 17, the verse 8 to 4. 1 Kings 17, the 8 to 4. It says, then the word of the Lord came to him, that is Elijah, saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belonged to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. He said, see, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. Go. I have commanded a widow to provide for you. Let's see what happened. He said, so he arose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. Now the Lord has appeared unto Elijah. And he said, Elijah, go to Zarephath. I have prepared a widow to provide for you. Now in the mind of Elijah, Elijah will be thinking, why there is hunger? I am hungry. The Lord has asked me to go to a woman in Zarephath to provide for me. Therefore, in the mind of Elijah, I am going to a woman who have abundance, who can supply and what to supply my need, or who can give me some food to eat. But look at what God has done. He said, go to Zarephath. I have prepared a woman to give you food. Now, if I am sending you somewhere to get something, you have in your mind is that wherever I am sending you, whatever you are going for has been, what that person you are going to take something from has got more than enough to supply. He has got abundance. He has got something to give to you. I will not send you somewhere where there is nothing for you. I'll always send you somewhere where there is something. In the whole of Zarephath, God did not get any house to send you than to send you to a widow who has nothing. But look at what happened. He said, when he came to the gate of the city, indeed, a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. Now, Elijah was talking out of confidence because he knew that it is God who has sent him. And God would never say, God is all knowing. God is all seeing. And God knows that I want food. It is food that I want to eat. That is why he has sent me to this woman. And therefore, I believe that this woman has more than enough to give to me. Therefore, she asked the woman without any hesitation. She asked the woman without what hesitation, bring me water. But if you go, please bring me bread. Because the Lord has spoken to me. And I believe that you have got enough to give. That is why he spoke without any hesitation. He spoke without any hesitation. But look at the response of the woman. Please bring me a little water and that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. So she said, as the Lord God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering and a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. Elijah, you are expecting me to bring bread, but look, I have got no bread. All I have got is flour and a little oil. I am going, as you can see, I am gathering sticks that I may prepare this, that my son and I will eat this and die. So as you see me, I am going to take my last breath and die. I am going to take my last breath and die. This is the woman whom God has sent Elijah to go and get food. In our weakness, God is our strength. It doesn't matter the situation. It doesn't matter the condition in which you are in. When God says yes, everything
must what? It will come to pass. When God says yes, nobody says no. When God says something must happen, it will happen. Irrespective of the situation, irrespective of what you are going through, I don't know where you stand now. Maybe you are like a woman. You are going to prepare your last food and die. Maybe you are at the point where you have given up. Maybe you are at the point you are saying you are finished. Anything at all should happen. I am finished. I am tired in life. I am tired with life. I want to end it all. Anything at all can happen. Because I have come to an end. There is nothing more I can do. The situation is too much for me. The condition in which I'm in, I cannot bear. I have given up in life. Tonight I am encouraging you that God can turn that situation around. Irrespective of whatever it is, God can turn it around. In your weakness, that is where the strength of God prevails. In your weakness, that is when God lifts up his hands. Because he doesn't want to share his glory. The woman said to Elijah, I need to go and I'm gathering the sticks. I am going to prepare this last flour that I've got with myself and my son will eat that we may not die. I have got nothing. As for water, I can give you water. But for the food, it is the last thing that I'm going to eat with my son and my what that we may die. That we may die. Now listen to what Elijah said. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. He said what? Do not fear. Woman, do not fear. I know the God who has spoken to me. I know the God who has sent me to your house. I know the God who gave me this word to come to you. It doesn't matter whether it is your last bit that you want to eat and die with your wife, with your son. Go and prepare it. I know the God that I serve. I know the God that I serve. I know that my God can provide. That is why he sent me to you. Therefore, I am telling you, go and prepare as I have directed you. He said, and Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as I have said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me. And afterwards, make some for yourself and your son. The woman has spoken. He has said to Elijah, now it is the last flour that I am going to prepare and eat with myself and my son. Now here you are telling me that I should go and prepare the first cake for you and then prepare some for myself and my son. Where am I going to get the material to prepare this food? Where am I going to get the ingredients to prepare this food? I have already told you that this is my last bit, and you are asking me to prepare it for you and go ahead and prepare some for myself and my son. Where am I going to get this? But Elijah knew what she was talking about. He knew what he was talking about. He knew the God that has sent him, that in our weakness, that is where his strength prevails. Where we think there is nothing, our God, that is where he provides. That is where he provides. Elijah knew the God that he was talking about. He knew what he was saying. He knew what he was saying. In your weakness lies God's strength. The woman was about to die. The woman was about to die. But the Lord wanted the last bit that he had that he may bless her. The Lord wanted the last bit that he had that he may bless her. I don't know the point where you are. I don't know what you are going through. And I don't know what God is demanding of you. But if you should be obedient to your God, if you should listen to the voice of God, his glory will be seen manifested in your life. Respecting the voice of God will cause a miracle in your life. I don't know what God is demanding of you, and I don't know the kind of excuses that you are giving to God. But if you should obey the voice of God in your weakness, if you should follow the directions of God and take the step that he wants you to take, where you think it is impossible, if you should take that step, the blessing actions of God will fulfill in your life. When God speaks, my brother, my sister, when God speaks, you don't have to look at the situation around you. You don't have to look at the circumstance in which you are in. You have to listen to what people will say. You don't have to consider the things that the eyes will see. You don't have to consider the things that the ears will hear. Just hearken unto the voice of God and act accordingly, and His glory will be seen in your life. If the woman had considered that I had only a bit of flour and oil, which I've got to prepare for my son and myself and eat and die, if she had considered the ingredients that she had, she wouldn't have prepared the food for Elijah. But when she obeyed the voice of God, let us read what happened. Then he said, then the woman, they led her to, and bring it to me, and afterwards make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, for thus says the Lord God of Israel. I am not saying these words. I am not saying these words. This thing that I am telling you, it is not coming from me. It is coming from God. She made the woman aware where the instructions were coming from. Then what? For thus says the Lord of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. Until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. This is the command from God. This is the word of God. I want you to take a step. I want you to take your last bit. I want you to take a step of faith that the glory of God will be seen in your life. I want you to take that bold step. Yes, at the moment, there is only a little flour and oil. But I want you to take a step. I want you to take a step and give that which you have to me. And the Lord God, here is word. There's his word that he will run. He will cause that flour never to finish. Or that flour shall not be used up. Nor the oil run dry. So it will never finish if you should give. If you should take that step of faith, the provision of God will be sufficient in your life. I don't know, as I said, what God is asking you. But when God speaks and you stay in obedience, His hand will be glorified in your life. His mighty hand will be seen moving in a very special way in your life. God wants to bless you. God wants you to take you out of that situation. God wants to deliver you. It is only up to you to listen to the voice of God and take that step of faith. And take that step of faith. The woman took the step. She hearkened to the voice of God. He said, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel." She hearkened to the voice of God. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. According to the word of God, which he spoke by Elijah. She took the step of faith. She took the step of faith. In your weakness, there lies the strength of God. If you would only listen to the voice of God, if you would only hearken to the instructions of God, the power of God will be seen moving in a very special way in your life. For the power of God to be seen manifest in your life is what is to obey the voice of God. In your weakness, irrespective of the situation in which you are in, irrespective of the circumstances that surround you, obey the voice of God. Hearken unto the voice of God. Cling to your God, and His glory will of the sin moving in your life. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were about to be thrown in the fire. Nebuchadnezzar said, hit the furnace 7 times, that it may scatter, that they may bow down to my God. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in their weakness, having nothing to do, because the king has spoken, there is no way they can stop that action from taking place. There was no way they could walk, stop that action from taking place. If Nebuchadnezzar said they should go, they should be thrown in the fire, nobody can stop it because he was a king. And they were, thrown in the fire. He said, hit that furnace 7 times, that they may know that I am serious. I don't care the favor I have given them. I don't care how much I love them. But I have made a decree that they must follow. And if they don't follow, throw them into the what? Into the furnace. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not look at the circumstances around them. Did not look in at what, consider the conditions that surrounded whatever decree that has been made. All they knew was their God. All they knew was their God. When they had nothing to do, in their weakness, when they are at the point of death, they had nothing to do. They decided to do what? Nothing. All they had to do was to say, yes, Nebuchadnezzar, we are going to bow to this God, and they'll be free. But what, they stood in the Lord. They obeyed the voice of God. They obeyed in the voice of God. Because they knew that their God would save them. He said, if you should throw us in this furnace, we are ready to die. But we know our God will deliver us. But even if he doesn't deliver us, we are ready to die for his name's sake. What state are you in? What state are you in? Are you giving up in your weakness? Are you giving up in your weakness? Are you giving up where you think you can do nothing? Are you giving up where the condition is so mad that you think you have no control over? There is somebody who is in charge. There is a God up there who is in control, who is whose power is perfected in your weakness. There is a God up there once again whose power is perfected in your weakness. So it doesn't matter the situation. It doesn't matter the condition. God is about to glorify himself. His power is about to be perfected in your life. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood and they were thrown in the fire. And Nebuchadnezzar said, I can see a fourth person in that fire. Nebuchadnezzar said, I can what? See a fourth person in that fire. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were thrown in the fire. Those who threw them in the fire got burned. But their hair was not burnt. No part of their body was burned, because in their weakness, the power of God was perfected. The presence of God was there. Therefore, fire did not have power over their lives. Fire did not have power over their lives, because they trusted in their God. Because they did not look at the circumstances around them. They did not look at the conditions. They stood for their God. They obeyed the voice of their God. And in their weakness, their God glorified himself. In their weakness, their God delivered them. I don't know what you are going through. I don't know what the enemy is saying to you. I don't know what the enemy is showing you. But I am telling you tonight, I am encouraging you tonight, that stand firm in the Lord. Continue to believe in the Lord, for his power is about to be perfected in your life. It doesn't matter how far the enemy has pushed you up. It doesn't matter the names that they are calling you up. It doesn't matter the disgrace that has come upon your life. I am telling you tonight that God is about to perfect his power. It's about to be perfected in your life. The Israelites said, yes, here come the Egyptians. They are following us. Moses, you bring us here that we may die in the desert, where we die at the end of tombs, in the land of Egypt, where we could be buried in, that you should bring us here in this desert that we may die. They had given up. They looked at the conditions. They looked at the situation that was surrounding them. But God was not looking at that. His power was about to be perfected. He said, Moses, stretch forth that stick upon the Red Sea. It will part into two. And my power will be seen. He delivered the Israelites and destroyed the Egyptians. His power was perfected. His power was perfected in the weakness of the Israelites. God's power was perfected. The Bible says, well, he hardened the heart of Pharaoh. He hardened the power, the heart of Pharaoh, that he may show him that he is God, that his power may be perfected. I have shown this man all miracles that I need to show him. I have done all things that I have to do to free my children from him. But I need to show him that I am God. I need to show him that I am God. Therefore, they chased him up. And what? The power of God was shown in the Red Sea. The Lord showed that he is a great man. The Lord showed that he is a God of all authority. God is about to glorify himself. God is about to magnify himself. That is why you can see the enemy at you. That is why you can see the enemy seriously having his way in your life. God is about to destroy. God is about to show his power. His power is about to be perfected in your life. God is about to make a way where there is no way. That is why everything seems impossible. That is why everything has gone bad. He is about to perfect his power in your life. He is about to show his strength in your life. If you would stand firm in the Lord, if you would take steps of faith, if you would be bold in your God, if you would hearken unto your voice, if you should know the kind of God that you serve and follow his step and his directions, the Lord's power will be perfected in your life. The Lord's power will be perfected in your life. The steps that the Lord may ask you to take may not seem sensible. But it is his way of glorifying himself. Remember, his word says his senses are above yours as the heavens are above the earth. Therefore, you would never understand his directions. He said, neither his thoughts are your thoughts. Therefore, you can never understand what God, the way God does his things. All you need to do as a child of God is to obey his voice. All you need to do as a child of God is to follow his instructions, and his power will be perfected in your life. His power will be perfected in your life. His power will be perfected in your life. God is about to do something in your life. God is about to glorify himself in your life. My brother, my sister, don't consider the situation in which you are in. Don't consider what the Lord is asking you to do. Because it is a way that he can perfect himself in you. It is a way that he can glorify himself in you. You would never understand the ways of God. You would never understand the thoughts of God. Therefore, my brother, my sister, hearken unto his voice. It doesn't matter how weak you are. It doesn't matter how weak you are. God is your strength. God is your strength. And in that weakness of yours lies the perfection of his power. In that weakness of yours lies the perfection of your power, of God's power. In that failure that you think you are lies the success of God. In that failure which you think you are in lies the success of God. That failure has to come for the success of God to be revealed. You have to go down that God can lift you up. So it doesn't matter how far the enemy has pushed you. It is for a reason. God is about to lift you up. Job was reduced to nothing. Job was reduced to nothing. But God lifted him up. God lifted him up. He lost everything in life. But God doubled it. I don't know what you have lost in your life. I don't know what you are expecting in your life. I don't know what you have given up on. But my brother, my sister, I am encouraging you tonight that stand on your feet as a child of God and believe that whatever your weakness is, God is your strength. And he is about to perfect himself in you. He is about to perfect himself in you. It doesn't matter how that sickness, how far that sickness has taken you, or how you have given up on the, as for this sickness, that is what is going to kill me. I want you to stop saying that as a child of God. I want you to stop saying that as a child of God. One thing I want you to know, that what the Lord has said concerning your life, that is the only thing that will come to pass. What the Lord has said concerning you, that is the only thing that will come to pass. That sickness is only temporary. The will and purpose of God is about to fulfill in your life. It doesn't matter what the doctors have said. It doesn't matter what the doctors have said. It doesn't matter what people are saying. What the Lord has said will stand. His power is about to be perfected in your life. His power is about to be perfected in your life. Don't listen to what people are saying. Don't listen to what people are saying. Oh, look at how bad this marriage is. I don't think there is any success for this. But look at how far the enemy has destroyed this marriage. There is no hope for this marriage. But I want you to know that if you would stand as a child of God and believe in your God, the power of God is about to be perfected in that marriage. The power of God is about to be perfected in that marriage. It doesn't matter how many years that you have gone through that pain. It doesn't matter how many years that you have gone through it. In God's own time, his power will be perfected in your life. He said, in your weakness is my strength. In your weakness is my strength. In your weakness is my strength. My brother, my sister, don't give up. God has not given up on you. God has not given up on you. And since he has not given up on you, don't give up on yourself. Since God has not what given up on you, don't give up on yourself. The only time God gives up on you is when you are dead. That one, he has finished with you on earth. But so long as you are alive, he has not finished with you. So long as you live, the Lord has not finished with you in this life. Whatever he has said or whatever he has purposed for your life will surely come to pass. So don't give up. Don't let the situation cause you to give up. Leave it all to God. Commit it all into the hands of God. And allow his word, his power to be perfected in your life. The widow did not give up. She did not look at the situation. She did not look at the conditions. She obeyed the voice of God, and the power of God was perfected for her and her household. Moses did not look at the Egyptians coming. He believed what was in his hands. He believed what was in his hands. And what? He followed the voice of God. And through that, the Lord destroyed their enemies. My brother, don't give up. The Lord has given you some power. The Lord has given you some authority over the situation. Just hack
hearken to the voice of God. Just stay in obedience to the voice of God, and His power will be perfected in your life. God richly bless you. It is my prayer that the power of God be perfected in your life. It is my prayer that the hand of God will be lifted up upon that situation. It is my prayer that the Lord will grant you faith, that you may be able to wait for His timing, that His name may be glorified in your life. I pray that the Lord will strengthen you. I pray that the Lord will strengthen you in your weakness, that you may be able to stand and wait for His time. I pray that whatever hand of the enemy that is lifted up upon your life may wither. I pray that any fear that the enemy has placed in you, preventing you from receiving from your God, be destroyed in Jesus' name. It is my prayer that from today you will walk in faith. It is my prayer that from today you will walk expecting from God, that all glory, all honor, all adoration shall be unto Him. May He protect you. May He cover you under the shadow of His hands. May He grant you sweet dreams even as you lay down to sleep. May He cause the rest of your week to be blessed, that in the end, all glory, all honor, all adoration shall be unto His name. In Jesus' mighty name, I do pray with thanksgiving. Amen. God richly bless you.